Rhabdomyolysis is a serious medical disorder resulting from too much exercise, and I believe it's more common than most people realize. Hey, it's Joe Cannon from supplementclarity.com and joe-cannon.com, and rhabdo is the topic for today's video. If you're not familiar with this topic, I'm hoping to hopefully save you some time and effort and money if this ever happens to you, and especially if you're about to join a fitness center, there are some things you need to be aware of. So let me just jump right into it, and hopefully this will clear everything up for you and make this video worthwhile. So before we go any further, what is rhabdo? Rhabdomyolysis is essentially muscle fiber deaths, skeletal muscle fiber death. What happens is people exercise so intensely that the contents of their muscles enter the bloodstream after the muscle dies, and this can cause some really bad things happening, such as people can go into heart attacks when they have rhabdo, they can suffer kidney problems resulting in dialysis. Kidneys often get a lot of attention when it comes to rhabdomyolysis, but I want you to realize that it's not just your kidneys that we have to worry about. Your liver can have issues as well. Doctors often will test for elevated liver enzymes when people have rhabdo. There is an intense muscle pain, and I can't underestimate how significant this is. Guys, I have been told by individuals the pain was so bad, people wanted to die. This pain is unbearable for some individuals. They often experience pain when they're not moving, and that's very different than what you have when you have regular muscle soreness. I'll link to a video I've done previously with rhabdo and delayed muscle soreness so you can get an idea of the difference between them. But it's a very intense muscle pain. Sometimes the worst pain you've ever experienced. There could be swelling of the muscle. You can see the swelling yourself. This muscle swelling can sometimes prevent your arms and or legs from extending or bending. And some people have even told me the swelling was preventing people from fitting into their clothing, their jeans, for instance. So it is a significant muscle swelling. This actually could require surgery to correct in some cases. And there's also many people report muscle weakness after getting rhabdo. And the weakness is interesting because it doesn't go away sometimes right off the bat. People sometimes report to me that this muscle weakness can persist for 6 months, 7 months, 9 months after get out of the hospital. So I believe rhabdo is for some individuals a long-term situation that I don't think a lot of people are actually addressing, that I think people should be addressing. And then the last issue I've jotted down this slide is post-traumatic stress disorder. I believe people who go through rhabdo do suffer from PTSD. Think of it this way. Rhabdo is a shock. No one's heard of it. You try to work out and better yourself. Next thing you know, you're in the hospital on dialysis. You've got a bunch of doctors and nurses around. You've spent a week in the hospital, if not more, and you may have been told you can't exercise again. And then if you want to go back to exercise, you're afraid to do it. Everybody tells me the same thing when they get rhabdo. I've never heard of this before, and I'm terrified to get it again. So I do believe they go through a post-traumatic stress disorder. I don't believe I hear anybody talking about this with the exception of me. And so I really want people to realize that this is an issue that for some people, it may take some time getting over. Again, I do believe you can exercise again after getting rhabdo. That's probably going to be a video for a later date. But what I want to do is leave this stuff alone for now, and let's just jump right into the meat of the video. And that's my five reasons why I believe fitness centers are accidentally causing rhabdomyolysis. So let's jump right into it. Number one is lack of education. As I often say, the best defense against rhabdo is education. The issue here is that few talk about rhabdo, few teach about rhabdo. And if you're a personal trainer right now and you're watching this video, stop the video and go get your personal training textbooks and go to the index and see if rhabdo is listed. Odds are it's not. I've got the textbooks of a lot of fitness organizations here at my home, and I don't see rhabdo mentioned in any of them. That's one of the reasons why I wrote the first book ever on exercise and rhabdo. It's simply called Rhabdo. And I wrote that up because no one talked about it. And I was frustrated with this. Prior to that book, I wrote the first personal training textbook to address rhabdo. Again, a lot of frustration on my part after listening to people's stories over the years and realizing that nobody's talking about this. So I don't say this to prop myself up or anything like that, but there's a lot of people out there talking about rhabdo these days, and they want you to think they're the expert. They're not. I am probably the top expert in America on this topic. topic. And that's just not just because I wrote the books. My day, every day, begins reading the Rhabdo research. I've been doing it for a decade. I am a Rhabdo nerd, what you could say, when it comes to this. But I do that because I want to promote the knowledge of Rhabdo in the community, and so not in the world community, actually, so people realize what this is, how significant it is. And again, I just don't want to talk about the fitness organizations that don't talk about this as well. I've met people in college who graduated recently, sometimes with master's degrees in exercise science. They've never been taught it. I don't understand why. I find it hard to believe their professors are not aware of it. But again, why not? So my challenge to you is this. If you are in college right now for exercise science, this would be an excellent topic for you to write a paper on. And so what I'll do is I'll link to some other articles I've written on Rhabdo, which link to the research, so you can, you know, save yourself some time and energy and go use some of that research in your own term papers. But I think this would be a really good topic for college students to address in class, because the people that I've met, many of them have never heard of it. So again, few like to talk about Rhabdo, and I do think that is the number one reason why Rhabdo is occurring in fitness centers, but it's not the only reason. We live in an era where people think that intense exercise is the best way to exercise, and that's really not true. So I believe that this false belief that intense exercise is appropriate for everybody is another reason why Rhabdo is occurring in fitness centers, and it's not really the truth at all. Again, for the personal trainers watching this or the other individuals who may not be in the fitness industry, again, we've got to work within our own confines, and if you are a novice, again, I don't think you need to be exercising intensely. If you're taking a group exercise class or a cycling class or something like that, you know, don't be afraid to walk out of the class. The class is probably going to last 45 minutes, an hour. If you've never taken a cycling class before, walk out when you've had enough. Don't try to finish the entire class. Don't push through your mental breaking point. You know, just get up and leave. Okay. So again, intense exercise, whether it's in a group exercise setting, or whether you're working one-on-one with a personal trainer or on your own, that's not the way to go, especially if you have any kind of health disorders. We always got to consider your medical issues, your health issues, when we prescribe exercise to that individual. So again, some people, sure, they can exercise intensely, but again, that beginner, that novice, if you will, has no need to do this. Okay, so I'm gonna call this reason number two why intense exercise is, or exercise is causing rhabdomyolysis, this false belief that everybody needs HIIT training, for instance, and it's just not true. Reason number three is the 30-minute workout. Well, what is that? If you join a fitness center or if you get a personal trainer, you may find that the personal training session lasts only 30 minutes long. Now, why do fitness centers do this? They're trying to help people fit fitness into their lifestyle. A lot of people say they don't have the time to exercise an hour, and so they fitness centers have tried to adapt to the comments of some of their members, and they've shrunk down the personal training session to only 30 minutes long. And again, people can sometimes do that amount of exercise. But when you combine that with maybe a fitness trainer who A, does not know about Rhabdo, and B, wants you to get your money's worth, many times they will try to squeeze a high intense workout into that short period of time. This can lead to rhabdo because the more sets, the more reps, the more weight you lift, for instance, the more intense the workout. And when you're doing things you're not used to doing, all this can trigger rhabdomyolysis. And so I do, in a roundabout sort of way, blame that 30-minute workout, but mostly it's because people are exercising within that 30-minute confines too intensely for their own good. Number four, the salesman personal trainer. Okay, I don't think you can straddle two worlds. You're either a salesman or a personal trainer. I don't think you can do both effectively. That's my own opinion. But if you, say, join a personal training or personal training gym or a fitness center, obviously it's going to be a salesperson who signs you up. Sometimes they will say to you, well, if you join today, I'll train you for free for a day or 2 days or a week or something like that. Well, okay, that can actually sweeten the pot a little bit. But if you are faced with this individual, the first question you should ask them is, are you a certified personal trainer? And if the answer is yes, ask to see their certificate, their personal training certification. It's going to have their name on it, and it's also going to have an expiration date. Take notice of the expiration date, because if the certification has expired, they're no longer a certified personal trainer. And if they say, for instance, well, I don't have the certificate with me, okay, one little question you might want to ask them is, who are you certified by? There's a whole bunch of different organizations that certify personal trainers. And when you ask a personal trainer this, they usually say to you, oh, I'm certified by ACE or NSCA or something like that. Everybody's got these letters that they say they're certified by. Great, wonderful. Ask them, what do those letters stand for? If they can't tell you in 1 second what those letters stand for, walk away from them. That's my one question litmus test for personal trainers. Nobody likes that I say that, but it works very effectively on many individuals because people aren't used to reciting what the letters stand for. They just throw the letters out. If you ask me, Joe, who are you certified by? NSCA, National Strength and Conditioning Association. I want it to roll off their tongue just as easily as I just said to you. Okay. So that would be one question I'd ask for them. The other thing I'd say to them is, well, do you know anything about Rhabdo? And again, if they can't tell you in 1 second what Rhabdo is, just give you a brief overview of it, then maybe that's not the personal trainer for you. In addition to that, you might also want to get to more crux of the problem. Do you have any experience working with somebody who has maybe your issues? If you have heart disease, arthritis, diabetes, high blood pressure, I want that personal trainer to have some experience working with you and your particular needs. Okay, so don't just assume all personal trainers may be able to help you. Again, there's brain surgeons and foot surgeons and heart surgeons out there. You know, again, personal trainers sometimes specialize as well. I do, for instance. So again, I want you to find someone who has your best interest at heart. It may not always be the salesperson, okay? Sometimes it is, but sometimes it's not. So always investigate that, all right? Now, number five, I saved, unfortunately, the most infamous for last. And that is maybe a personal trainer, a fitness trainer, if you will, who tries to make you sore on purpose. Sometimes when you join a fitness center, they give you a free personal training session, maybe one session, two sessions, whatever. And sometimes the personal trainer who is working with you may be told on the side, your job during these free personal training sessions is to beat the daylights out of that person on purpose. Make them as sore as you possibly can a day or two later. They're trying to elicit delayed muscle soreness. Why would they do this? Well, the idea here is if a novice wakes up the next day and they're really, really sore, they'll think, oh my goodness, I'm really out of shape. I got to hire that personal trainer. They're using muscle soreness to try to sell personal training. This is unethical. It is unconscionable. And I know it goes on because personal trainers come up to me in private many times and they say to me, yeah, that's what they tell us to do. Doesn't happen all the time. Doesn't happen everywhere. But it happens enough that I think you should be aware of it. Now, again, number one, it is unconscionable and ethical to do this. But again, think about it. You got a personal trainer who don't know about Rhabdo. You got a salesman or a owner, or you got a fitness director, et cetera, who don't know about Rhabdo. And all they're thinking about is make them sore so they'll hire the personal training and make more money off of them. But in the reality, what they could be doing on a roundabout sort of way is causing rhabdomyolysis. So again, it gets back to lack of education. But regardless, it is unethical to make somebody sore to try to sell a product. And it infuriates me when I hear this. And I've heard it enough over the years that I need for you to be aware of it just in case you're ever faced with this. Okay. So in summing up, these are my five reasons why fitness centers are causing rhabdomyolysis. Number one is lack of education. Again, I can't hammer this message enough. Most personal trainers in the world do not know what rhabdo is. And I don't mean personal trainers. I mean group fitness instructors, cycling instructors, Zumba instructors, yoga instructors, etc. They're not taught it, unfortunately. And so that's why I get so passionate when I discuss this topic in classes I teach. Lack of education is the number one reason why rhabdo is occurring everywhere. False belief in intense exercise is best for everyone. No, it's not. For some it is, but if for a novices should not be exercising intensely. That is not the right way to do things. I'll do another video at some point on what I think is the best way for a novice to exercise. Point number three is the 30-minute workout. Nothing wrong with working out 30 minutes. It's just when you combine it with intense exercise. Intense exercise, especially also unusual things you're not used to, squeezed into that 30-minute time frame, can trigger rhabdomyolysis. Many people have told me over the years that's actually how they got rhabdo. And then number four, the salesperson slash personal trainer. Again, I want to know who that salesperson is. I want to know, are they really a certified personal trainer? Sometimes they're not. Just to be on the safe side, always ask for the certificate, look at the expiration date, etc., and then quiz them. Again, ask them real fast, what do those letters stand for, and see what answer you get. And then number five, under no circumstances should anyone try to make anybody sore for the purposes of selling personal training. It is one of the dirty little secrets in the fitness business that nobody wants to talk about, and that's why I brought it up. All five of these are, in my opinion, the reasons why rhabdo is becoming more common. So that's all I got for you right now, guys. If you got any questions, leave a question below. I'll address it myself. If you have gotten rhabdo in a fitness center, tell me your story below. I would love to discuss it with you and maybe address any questions you have. I'll put links to my books and other articles I've written on rhabdo in the description below. Until next time, guys, I'm Joe Cannon. Have yourself a great day.